Whatever list of user classes you end up with, you have to ask yourself, who can I talk to learn the requirements for each user class? This is where the idea of the product champion comes into play. We started this approach in my small software development group at Kodak about 1986. We realized that we needed to find a better way to understand requirements. We needed to get closer interactions with the users of our systems. So we said, okay, let's make sure that for every project we work on, we have one or a small number of user representatives working closely with the software team. We called these people product champions. This is not the same kind of champion as the funding sponsor for the project. These people are product champions in terms of being advocates for the capabilities of the new system. Our product champion served as the primary interface between the IT and customer communities from the customer side, in the same way that the analyst serves in that function from the IT side. So in this model, the primary conduit through which requirements information flows is one or more requirements analysts working with one or more product champions. Ideally, these people will be real users, actual members of the user class that they're representing. They won't be managers of the users or the higher-level management sponsor who really should be holding the business requirements. And probably the worst case is to have a software developer saying, gee, if I was a user, here's what I'd want. That's usually not a good way to get at the real user needs. Sometimes the champion is a subject matter expert who's an authority on the application domain. However, you must be sure that the subject matter expert is well connected to the actual users and can really speak for their needs. The product champion is not just a reference that you can go to obtain understanding. He's also someone who's going to be making a lot of decisions at the user requirements level. One of the most valuable jobs that our product champions performed was to reconcile conflicts. If you talk to multiple people about their needs, you're going to hear conflicting information, and someone has to resolve all that. Who better to resolve a lot of these conflicts than a knowledgeable, experienced user who's in a position to make those choices? It's not reasonable to ask an analyst or a developer to do a good job of making those choices. So the goal is to have the product champions and the analyst work together to provide the development team with a unified set of requirements. When I ask my seminar audiences if they've tried the product champion model, there are almost always some people in the audience who have used an approach similar to this, and they almost always say it worked really well if three conditions were met. First, the product champions need to understand and sign up for their responsibilities. Second, they need to have the time available to do the job. And third, they have to be empowered and authorized to make binding decisions at the user requirements level. Now, sometimes managers are uncomfortable delegating this kind of decision-making authority to mere mortals. The concern is that the users are going to go crazy, adding all kinds of interesting functionality. They're going to color outside the scope lines, and the project will have every bell and whistle in it and will never finish. And that's an understandable concern. To address that concern, we have the system of checks and balances by defining the business requirements first. So we've defined our scope, which identifies the boundaries the project team works within. I think that separating the business requirements from the user requirements makes it more comfortable to managers to feel like, yes, we can take knowledgeable users and give them that authority to work on the user requirements within the defined project scope without fear that the project will go out of control. But we also have a change mechanism by which if someone comes up with ideas that are currently out of scope but ought to be in scope, we can cycle back to the business requirements owners and see about modifying the scope to accommodate the new ideas. We found it very helpful to actually write down the expectations we held of our product champions. If you ask someone to do this job, they need to know what that means and what you're looking for them to do. What do you do when one person can't provide all of the voice of the customer input, which is typically the case? When you have multiple user classes, you need multiple product champions. The chemical tracking system provides a good example of how we approach this on our larger projects. On the chemical tracking system, we had an overall project manager, a woman named Lori, who doubled as one of the analysts. I was an analyst on that project, serving as an internal Kodak consultant to help with the requirements issues. And then we had a third programmer analyst named Jackie, who worked with two other small user classes. So I worked with the chemists, and these two other analysts worked with our three other major user classes. My product champion for the chemist user class was this guy named Don that I mentioned earlier. But we realized that Don, as good as he is, can't represent all the needs of all the chemists in a place the size of Kodak. So we tried to help him out. We assembled a backup team with five other chemists from different parts of the company who had slightly different experiences and perspectives and needs. So that group of six people was our voice of the customer for the chemists, but Don was clearly first among equals. So if those folks didn't agree, we did what Don said. I'll tell you, as an analyst, this makes your life a whole lot easier. This approach worked extremely well for us. Each of the user representatives can go back and interact with the members of their natural work group, so the analysts can indirectly reach out and touch a lot of people through this kind of representation mode. We only set up a backup team when we had a lot of diversity in our user class, really sub-user classes perhaps, as we did with the chemists. In contrast, there were only a few employees in the chemical stockroom, so there was no need to formalize a representation model there. The manager of the chemical stockroom provided most of the needs as the product champion, and she could talk to the people in her group on a daily basis about what was going on. That was good enough for this group of users. This figure shows lines between the product champions, because issues will come up across multiple user classes that have to be resolved. So then you go back to your overall decision makers. For this project, the four product champions and the three IT people I've mentioned made up our decision-making team.